and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the sheep of his hand. Father, we are so grateful that we are yours. We are your people, we are your sheep, and you are our great shepherd. We come before you this morning, Father, with thanksgiving. We come before you to offer you praise and adoration. We come, Father, to open your word together to hear your voice. We are your temple, gathered together here in this place. We individually and corporately are the dwelling place of your Spirit. And so, Father, we plead with you this day, do all that you will, for all that you will is good. Do good to us. Do good, Father, to those who are here who do not know Christ and have never come to understand the gospel. Father, may you work within the lost, here in this place and around the world this day as your gospel goes forward, that many might be drawn to the Savior. And we will give you thanks for it, and we will give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Standing as we read the Word of God.
Morning's reading will be the Song of Solomon. We are at chapter 5. So we're reading the Song of Solomon, beginning of chapter 5. We'll be reading verses 1 through 8. Beginning in verse 1, the reading of the holy, inspired, inerrant Word of God. The Beloved, I have come to my garden, my sister, my spouse. I have gathered my myrrh with my spice. I have eaten my honeycomb with my honey. I have drunk my wine with my milk. To his friends, eat, O friends, drink, yes, drink deeply, O beloved ones. The Shulamite, I sleep, but my heart is awake. It is the voice of my beloved. He knocks, saying, open for me, my sister, my love, my dove, my perfect one. For my head is covered with dew, my locks with the drops of the night. I have taken off my robe. How can I put it on again? I have washed my feet. How can I defile them? My beloved put his hand by the latch of the door, and my heart yearned for him. I arose to open for my beloved, and my hands dripped with myrrh, my fingers with liquid myrrh, on the handles of the lock. I opened for my beloved, but my beloved had turned away and was gone. My heart leaped up when he spoke. I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. The watchmen who went about the city found me. They struck me. They wounded me. The keepers of the walls took my veil away from me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my beloved, that you tell him I am lovesick. You may be seated. So I don't know if you caught that through this reading. It took me several times and a couple commentators to figure it out. But we've been reading about the beloved, the love story between the Shulamite and her beloved. And we have gone through this and we've seen this. This is a great picture, a metaphor of the relationship of Jesus Christ with his bride, the church. But what we found in this passage, if you picked up on it, was, if you want to call it the first fight, okay? We have the beloved who was evidently at a big feast, and he comes to the Shulamite and he beckons her, and he beckons her with lovely words, my love, my perfect one. And of course, the church, the bride of Christ, is made perfect by his love, is made perfect by his sacrifice on the cross. And the Shulamite is in bed and she's thinking of her beloved, but she is delaying responding to his call. And she comes up with some excuses in verse 3. I've taken off my robe. How can I put it on again? I have washed my feet. How can I defile them? Of course, in the Eastern, at these times, they would wear sandals. And when you went to bed, you know, your feet would get very dirty during the day. And when she finally gets up and answers the call, he's gone. And she's totally distraught. Where did he go? And then she is going out throughout the town and speaking to the watchmen and so forth. So what do we take from this passage? Well, first of all, what's been striking me as we've gone through the Song of Solomon is the love story. And when we look at it as Christ and the church, you know, we can kind of draw those parallels. But how about if we look at it as Christ and me? And we really say to ourselves, do I have this love relationship with Jesus Christ personally? With my heart. And when I read the words of the Shulamite as she longs for her beloved, can I say that I look to Jesus Christ with that same devotion and love? Because brothers and sisters, you know, when we come to church and we strip off the externals of our attendance and our Bible study and our, you know, baptism and our fellowship, are we left with a living relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ? Because ultimately, that's what it's all about. And the Song of Solomon really brings forth for us that challenge, is if do we have that love relationship with Christ? And in this passage, we see that in times, maybe in your life, you have been lazy to answer the call of your Savior when he's been at the door. Maybe it's your laziness. Maybe it's your sin. Maybe it's your lack of prayer time or your lack of devotion to the Word. And then you decide it's time to see Christ, but maybe he's not there. You feel the heavens are far away and he's not there for you. How do you respond to that? Are you troubled? Does it bother you? Do you seek him with all of your heart when you can't find him? Or is it la-di-da? Oh well, I'll try again tomorrow. You know, when we go through the Psalms, I'm going to read a quote to you that I got from Matthew Henry. The royal psalmist never complains of anything with such sorrowful accents as God hiding his face from him. When God hides his face, do you feel it? And if you do, that's a great sign that you love your Lord and that he is a center of your life. But if you can live without him, you really have to seek him and look at this Song of Solomon and look at the love that we find between the Shulamite and her beloved and ask yourself, am I loving Christ in this way? Am I seeking him apart from the externals of religion? And that's the exhortation this morning, brothers and sisters. Seek your Savior Jesus Christ with a passion that this Shulamite looks for him in the streets when he cannot be found. Because we have the promise that I will never leave you nor forsake you. Brothers and sisters, he is there in his love. Seek him with all your heart and you will surely find him.
Father, we're grateful for this exhortation this morning. Who of us have not had that experience? A feeling as if you are far from us. Father, sometimes it is true that you withdraw the sense of your presence with us so that we might pursue you. Father, might we be those who love you so much that that would not even be an issue, that when we hear your knock, Father, we would immediately spring from our warm bed to welcome you. But Father, when those dry times do come, when it seems like our prayers are not getting through the ceiling, Father, may we just pursue you all the more until that fellowship with you is restored. May we willingly chase after you, confessing our sin, confessing our need, our dependence, so that our relationship with you is one of love and intimacy and closeness once more. Forgive us, Father. The fact is, we do not love you as we ought, and we confess that to you. We are called to love you with all of our being, and yet we do not, we cannot. Not until that day when you bring it to pass. Until then, Father, draw us close to you and give us a hunger for you. And we will give you thanks for it. Because you are ours and we are yours. You have sent your Son to bear our griefs and carry our sorrows. He was smitten of you and afflicted. He was pierced through for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. By his scourgings we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But you, Father, have caused the iniquity of all of us to fall upon him. And that is the basis upon which we can come into your presence and commune with you. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please take your Bibles and turn with me to Psalm 88 this morning. Psalm 88. A Psalm of the Sons of Korah. O Lord, the God of my salvation, I have cried out by day and in the night before you. Let my prayer come before you. Incline your ear to my cry, for my soul has had enough troubles. and my life has drawn near to Sheol. I am reckoned among those who go down to the pit. I have become like a man without strength, forsaken among the dead, like the slain who lie in the grave, whom you remember no more, and they are cut off from your hand. You have put me in the lowest pit, in the dark places, in the depths. Your wrath has rested upon me, and you have afflicted me with all your waves. You have removed my acquaintances far from me. You have made me an object of loathing to them. I am shut up and cannot go out. My eye has wasted away because of affliction. I have called upon you every day, O Lord. I have spread out my hands to you. Will you perform wonders for the dead? Will the departed spirits rise and praise you? Will your loving kindness be declared in the grave, your faithfulness in Abaddon? Will your wonders be made known in the darkness, and your righteousness in the land of forgetfulness? But I, O Lord, have cried out to you for help, and in the morning my prayer comes before you. O Lord, why do you reject my soul? Why do you hide your face from me? I was afflicted and about to die from my youth on. I suffer your terrors. I am overcome. Your burning anger has passed over me. Your terrors have destroyed me. They have surrounded me like water all day long. They have encompassed me altogether. You have removed lover and friend far from me. My acquaintances are in darkness. Father, we come to this most unusual of psalms. There are psalms that speak of the dread of the psalmist, of his loneliness, of the trials which he faces. But usually, Father, there is a turning point in those psalms. There is hope at the end. We find no such hope here, aside from the very first statement of the psalm, in which the psalmist, in spite of all of his troubles, all of his difficulties, all of his sorrows, yet still confesses that you are the God of his salvation. And there, Father, then that statement alone in this psalm, there is hope. It is a hope, Father, for which we pray in regard to those of your people who find themselves in this same kind of dark place, in this kind of despair. We are not excluded from such experience. We are yours, yes, and your spirit dwells in us, but we remain flesh. We remain unsanctified. And there are times, Father, when the cares and concerns of this world crowd in upon us, and we feel the burden, and the light dims, and we can no longer see your face. So, Father, how appropriate come to this psalm after the portion of Song of Solomon, which we just read, for they fit together hand in glove. These are the descriptions of those who feel that you are far from them, that perhaps you have turned away from them and abandoned them, and yet, Father, you remain the God of our salvation. So we pray, Father, you would lift up the heads of those who are downcast. We pray, Father, for those who carry great weights of burden, that you would lift those burdens from them and cause them to see your face once more. We pray, Father, for those who have drifted from you, whether due to their own sin, Father, their complacency, whatever the case may be, draw them back. If need be, Father, extend your hand of discipline. but bring them to repentance. Cause them to remember their first love. Kindle again within the hearts of each of your people that love that we once had for our Savior. May it burn brightly. May it rise up into a flame, Father, a flame of passion for you and for our Savior. Do these things, Father, and do them in the church at large as well, as we see so much of your church drifting away from the path that they once were on, as we see your church once again drifting from the truth, being concerned more with what the world thinks of it than with what you think of it. Restore your church, Father, to faithfulness. And maintain the faithfulness of this church. We plead with you. Do not let us drift. Cause us to remain firm upon your word, our solace, our authority, our life, and we will give you praise, for you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. Redeemer, but a great intercessor, a great mediator who sits at the right hand of the Father, praying for us constantly, interceding for us that God's will might be accomplished in our lives.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong love, perfect peace.
Oh,
Maybe I should just come forward. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so delighted. We are so overwhelmed with the graciousness of your love that you have showered upon us. We, your people, your church, your bride, corporately and individually give you thanks. We pray that as we submit our offerings, that you would be glorified, as our eyes are fixed and gaze upon you, so that your kingdom might grow and the benefits of what we collect might spread the gospel all throughout the world, so that you might be made known as the true God, and that you might receive glory upon the saving of everyone who hears the gospel. Be blessed and be glorified, my God. Amen.
And the sea returned to its normal state at daybreak, while the Egyptians were fleeing right into it. Then the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen, even Pharaoh's entire army that had gone into the sea after them. Not even one of them remained. But the sons of Israel walked on dry land through the midst of the sea, and the waters were like a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. When Israel saw the great power which the Lord had used against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Father, what a dramatic portion of your word. You are glorified in it. That was your purpose, and that purpose has been fulfilled. We read this and we see your great power, but we also see your great grace. Help us to see more clearly, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. I read a lot of commentaries. I haven't counted, but I'm probably reading roughly 10 to 12 commentaries as we work our way through this book of Exodus and dipping into another five or six here and there. And I'm so appreciative of the scholarship of these authors, these teachers that God has given to the church. We are blessed to have such a vast quantity of biblical teaching so readily available to us here in our day. And yet there are times when I read the scripture and then I consult the commentaries and I wonder if those scholarly men are reading the same Bible I am. Maybe it's just the way my mind works, but I seem to find much more humor in the scripture than you will find in these commentaries. And the humor seems so obvious to me, and yet no one else seems to see it, so I guess it's just me. My wife would probably agree. My son Ben and I share a common sense of humor that my wife just is baffled by. So allow me to give you some insight into what sometimes goes on in my head when I read the scripture. Last week, we said repeatedly that what God told Moses was to tell the people, just don't do something, stand there. And yet today we see what almost sounds like a contradiction of that. What's more, it almost sounds like Moses is being criticized for praying, of all things. Why are you crying out to me? The Lord says to Moses in verse 15. It's almost as if God is now saying to Moses, don't just stand there praying, do something. Solomon tells us that there is a time for everything under heaven, and apparently that includes prayer. So this is the picture I get in my mind when I read that. There's Moses down on his face crying out to God. And he's just pouring his heart out. He's down there on the ground and he's expressing his fears and his concerns for his people and his inadequacy at leading these people, his inadequacy for the task. And he's not doing this quietly either. He is crying out. And all the while, now this is the picture that comes into my mind. You're not going to find this on the pages of Scripture. There's the Lord, standing with his arms crossed, tapping his foot, rolling his eyes, looking at his watch, until finally he says, enough already. Let's get this show on the road. Why are you crying out to me? Tell the sons of Israel to go forward. I hear that, and that just makes me smile. What are we to make of all this? There are two things going on here in the deliverance of God's people. There his people stand with the Egyptian army in front of them and the sea to their rear, with God about to act on their behalf. And when he does so, he will first bring glory to his name, and secondly, he will manifest the wonder of his lavish grace. Those two themes, the glory of God and the grace of God to his people, echo throughout this passage. And I want to show you both of those this morning. The first thing we see in verses 15 through 18 is that God is glorified and his grace is demonstrated in his decree concerning the future of his people. All the waiting is over. The time has finally come. The climactic battle is at hand. It is the time of redemption, but it is also a time of faith. And God comes to Moses in verse 15, and he speaks those unusual and unexpected words, "Why are you crying out to me?" Not only is this amusing, it is also amazing. The children of Israel are surrounded by the Egyptians on one side. They have the sea on the other. And Moses begins to cry out to God for help. And God's response is, "Why are you crying out to me?" Now, it seems to me pretty obvious why Moses was crying out. But you see, what God is saying to Moses is essentially this. Moses, don't just pray, do something. The time for prayer is past. The time for action has come, because I've already told you what I'm going to do. I'm going to deliver you. You already know that. I'm getting ready now to answer the prayers that you have been praying. So your business right now is to trust me to get your people and go forward. When Charles Spurgeon preached on this verse, he said, "Far be it from me ever to say a word in disparagement of the holy, happy, heavenly exercise of prayer. But beloved, there are times when prayer is not enough, when prayer itself is out of season. When we have prayed over a matter to a certain degree, it then becomes sinful to tarry any longer. Our plain duty is to carry our desires into action, and having asked God's guidance, and having received divine power from on high, to go at once to our duty without any longer deliberation or delay." But this presents Moses with another problem, doesn't it? Which way is forward? Do we go forward toward the Egyptians? Or do we go forward toward the sea? And the Lord, of course, answers this question in the very next verse. In verse 16, he says, "As for you, lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the sons of Israel shall go through the midst of the sea on the dry land." So he commands Moses to divide the sea. He divulges to him in verse 16 that he is going to part these waters, and he is going to bring the children of Israel across on dry land. And you see what God has done here. In Exodus chapter 14, verse 1 through verse 14, he has put them in this position of great peril. They are in a condition of extreme stress. And it is precisely that situation, that he will accomplish his redeeming work. He puts them into the gravest of circumstances so that his glory and his grace will be manifested. He could have kept the Egyptians from coming after them at all. He could have had the way opened up across the sea before they ever got there. God could have done this in any number of different ways. but God has chosen to put them in a circumstance of great distress because that is the manner in which he would be most glorified and his grace would be most clearly manifest. And so here in verses 15 through 18, God is going to get glory for himself and show his grace to his people by telling them ahead of time what he is about to do to their enemies. Here's what I'm going to do, Moses. And then he walks him through it, and he proceeds to do precisely what he has just said. Moses is told that he is to serve as a visual focal point for what God is going to do. Moses, get your staff. Stand there, hold that rod out over the sea, and I will split the waters. And this was intended to emphasize once again that what is about to happen is not some kind of amazing natural coincidence. This is not some confluence of meteorological phenomenon combining to make a low tide and a salt marsh so that the children of Israel could walk across it. You may have heard the story about the liberal preacher who comes into the church and begins to talk about the crossing of the Red Sea. And as he does, someone shouts out, "Praise the Lord! Taking all those children through the deep waters. What a mighty miracle." Of course, the minister, who does not believe in miracles, becomes annoyed at this interruption. And so rather condescendingly, as liberal preachers are wont to be, he told the congregation that the Israelites were probably in a marshland with an ebbing tide, so they were simply wading through 6 inches of water. In response to this, the same voice cries out as before, "Praise the Lord! Drowning all those Egyptians in 6 inches of water. What a mighty miracle." There's nothing in this text that hints of anything natural. This is the supernatural work of God. Moses doesn't expect you to naturally explain it. And he emphasizes that in a couple of ways. Moses stretches out his staff in order to produce this, and it happens at just that time. And secondly, God sends a divine wind in order to part those waters. In both of those ways, the action of Moses and God's sovereign control of nature, we see that what is happening here is not a natural phenomenon. It is the supernatural work of God. The very point of the story is that there is no way to explain this apart from God. The sovereign God of heaven and earth, who is the creator and providential sustainer of all that is. He is the ruler and the redeemer. And he is the one who is intervening here in the most extraordinary way. There is nothing like the Exodus in all of the Old Testament. Over and over again, this is the point to which the psalmists and the prophets point back to as the quintessential Old Testament representation of God coming to the rescue of his people. The other authors of Scripture are continually pointing back to the Exodus and saying, look at what God has done. If he can do that, he can rescue you in whatever circumstance you find yourself. Is precisely the extremity of his people and their inability to help themselves in any natural way that serves to do what? To exalt the grace of God. To bring glory to his people. He's going to give them the law in a few chapters. It is vital that they understand before they receive the law carved into stone that the grace of God is the very reason they have been preserved. The very reason that they are the people of God is because of the grace of God. Not because they were clever. Not because There was some amazing confluence of natural events that allowed them to coincidentally escape the clutches of the Egyptians, but because God himself had intervened in this passage. In this passage through the Red Sea, God had brought them through it. Why? Because they are uniquely his. And God is going to give his law to his people, whom by his grace he has delivered. Verse 17, once again, God shows his sovereignty by emphasizing that he is going to harden the hearts of the Egyptians. This is explicitly emphasized in the second half of verse 17. As for me, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them, and I will be honored through Pharaoh and all his army, through his chariots and his horsemen. And then the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord, when I am honored through Pharaoh, through his chariots and his horsemen. Do you see the emphasis here? We're thinking about the Exodus. We're thinking about the people of Israel. We're thinking about their deliverance, their rescue. God's thinking about his honor. God's thinking about his reputation. He's thinking about his glory. Why is he going to harden the heart of Pharaoh? Why is he going to draw Pharaoh right into the bowels of the Red Sea? Because he's going to display his glory. And he's going to cause even the Egyptians to call him Jehovah. He is going to get honor from Pharaoh, from Pharaoh's army, from the chariots. He's going to get honor from Egypt. God gets glory for himself and shows his grace to his people, and he does so here by stating ahead of time what he's going to do and then doing it. Now, I just want to pause here and note, if you look at verse 18, it says, then the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I am honored through Pharaoh and his chariots, through his horsemen. That, of course, means that when God displays his sovereignty over Egypt in judgment, they will know that he is the Lord. Once again, you'll remember, we're being brought back a little ways in the book of Exodus to that point when Pharaoh said to Moses, who is this Jehovah you speak of? And now, in the destruction of Pharaoh and his entire army, God says, you will know who I am. You will know that, no, I am the Lord. I am Jehovah. You will know me by my personal name. You will know me as the God of Israel when I destroy you in the midst of the sea. What does that mean? That they will know him as Jehovah. It means that they will know that he is sovereign. This phrase occurs over and over in the Old Testament. And when it's said this way, that then they shall know that I am the Lord. In English, we don't understand the full import of this. But there is no way you can look at verse 18 that you can skirt around this fact. They will know that the God of Israel is the God who controls all things. He is the sovereign God of the universe. To know that God is the Lord is to know that he is the sovereign one, and any diminution of his sovereignty is a failure to know him as he is. There is nothing that occurs outside of the decree and the plan and the purpose of God. He is that Lord. He is that God. One last thing about this first section. The command to go forward is a command to exercise faith. Because there is a sea in front of them. And the author of Hebrews knows this. That's why he says in Hebrews 11:29 that by faith Israel passed through the Red Sea. It's an amazing moment when God says to Moses, okay, lead these people forward. And Moses looks out and there's just a big sea in front of them. God says, go forward. And by faith, the people believe God. They believe that He is going to make a way, and they start walking. Before the sea is split. So God glorifies Himself and manifests His grace through declaring what He will do and then doing that which He has declared. Now look at verse 19 and 20. Here we see God receiving glory and showing His grace through His divine protection of His people. His people are trapped. The Egyptian armies are upon them. And so now the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud that have been leading them and guiding them circled around to the back behind the camp. The people are moving toward the sea. And the pillars have been out in front of them. Now they circle about behind so that the pillars are between them and the Egyptians. The angel of God, who had been going before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from before them and stood behind them. So it came between the camp of Egypt and the camp of Israel. And there was the cloud along with the darkness, yet it gave light at night. Thus, the one did not come near the other all night. That is, the Egyptians did not come near to Israel all night. So the Egyptian armies are upon them, and now the pillar of cloud and fire, also being referred to as the angel of God, comes and sets themselves between the Egyptians and the Israelites, and God Himself becomes the bulwark, the fortress, which is protecting His people. It's interesting the language that's used here in verse 9, the angel, 19, the angel of God, which had been going before the camp. Notice how the angel of God is identified with the pillar. A couple of reasons for this, I think. First of all, the children of Israel know the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire are not some sort of inanimate magical objects that are the source of their protection. They are the visible representations of the presence of God with His people. But to emphasize that they are the visible representation of the presence of God with His people, the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud are identified here as the angel of God. Now they're identified as the angel of God, at least for this reason. The people of God know that God is not visible. He's a spirit. And He does not have a physical body. And yet they know that the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud are the manifestation of that one true God who is invisible. And they identify it as such. And so the angel of God moves around the camp. And it's not just that this inanimate, impersonal pillar of fire and pillar of cloud move around behind them. It is the visible action of God directly intervening between His people and their enemies. If you're in the position of the Israelites, that's going to be a great encouragement for you. Now we not only have words that we have to believe, but God in His grace has given us a visual representation of His own protection of us. He interposes Himself in between them and their enemies. That's a glorious picture. Right at your moment of greatest need, God is planting Himself between you and the threat, between you and the enemy of your soul. This is what God does. This is what He has done for you. The enemy of your soul is sin. And the consequence of sin is that you deserve the judgment of God. But one day, so long ago, on the cross, God interposed himself between you and his judgment. And he did so in the person of Jesus Christ. When Christ went to the cross, he took upon himself the punishment that you deserved so that you might become the righteousness of God in him. Now, can I point to one very interesting thing in verse 20? Something difficult to translate. The best translators struggle at it, but what's clear is that in the manifestation of the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud, the children of Israel saw the fire and had light where the Egyptians were in darkness. Joshua 24:7 recalls the very fact that the Egyptians were kept in darkness. He recounts this later on. Now, a couple of things going on there. Notice, first of all, God once again is making a distinction between his people and those who are not his people. His people were in the light. Those who were not his people were in darkness. Secondly, remember that Egypt worshipped Ra, the sun god. And yet, Israel has the light. Egypt is in darkness. God is once again displaying his sovereignty even over the gods of Egypt. Verses 21 through 22, we see once again God's glory and God's grace in leading his people through the sea. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land. So the waters were divided. And the sons of Israel went through the midst of the sea on the dry land, and the waters were like a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Remember again, as this parting occurs, what happened all the way back in Genesis chapter 1. When God was creating the world, one of the things that he did was to separate the sea from the dry land. And now look at what God is doing in redemption. He is separating the sea and making dry land for his people to go through. If you'll remember as well, God does something similar in the culmination of all things. What is one of the things we're told about the new heavens and the new earth? The Lord will separate the earth from the sea. John tells us there will no longer be any sea. What we are seeing in all of these separations of earth from sea are redemptive acts. What we are seeing here in the crossing of the Red Sea is a redemptive act. We are seeing a new creation in God's redemption. Moses is deliberately hearkening back and asking us to think back on what God did in creation. And he's showing us how in redemption, God is repairing that which was marred in the original creation. He's bringing about a new creation in the very work of the redemption of his people. And yet, as Genesis looks forward to the Exodus looks forward to the cross, and the cross looks forward to the ultimate culmination of all things in Christ, which is the great goal and completion of redemption, both in terms of the redemption of God's people and the redemption of this world, this creation. So Moses stretches out his hand, and we're told in verse 21 that the Lord sends an east wind. Now think this through. I'm terrible with directions. I believe GPS to be one of God's greatest gifts to mankind. But even I can figure this out. We're given direction here in the text. We're told that God divides the waters with a strong east wind. That means the wind is blowing east to west. Where are the children of Israel? Well, if they're leaving Egypt, then they're on the west bank of the Red Sea, intending to move to the east. Egypt is behind them. They're heading out into the wilderness, and and then to Canaan. So Israel is on the west bank of the Red Sea. The wind is coming from the east. So what are we seeing? It seems that the Israelites are standing there most of the night, watching the sea part from the other side. The language in verse 21 is this: the Lord swept back the sea by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land. It seems that God is requiring from Israel an exercise of faith. He's saying to them, watch how this unfolds. Look over your shoulder. Look who's behind you. And then look who's standing between, in between. And watch me part the waters on the other side. And then when the time comes, go through on dry land. Again, everything in this passage indicates the miraculous nature of it. But it's not instantaneous. It takes how long? We're told well into the night. Well into the night it is before the Egyptians themselves will attempt to follow the children of Israel across the sea. The language in verse 21 again: the Lord swept back the sea by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land. And so God shows his glory and his grace through this parting of the sea. None of the children of Israel could ever have said they did something in order to earn or obtain their own deliverance through the Red Sea. God had put them at a point where there was literally nothing that they could have done, nothing they could have contributed. They simply had to believe and then walk in the way God had for them. That's the gospel. My friends, that's the gospel. There's nothing that we can do, nothing we can contribute to our rescue, to our redemption, to our salvation. God does it all. And then he tells us to walk in the way that he has prepared for us. That's the gospel, the gospel here in Exodus. The grace of God freely given, not deserved, not earned. God simply comes for his own glory and delivers his people. And that is what God has done through Jesus Christ. He has offered this redemption through the blood of Christ. We cannot earn it. We cannot work for it. We cannot contribute to it. God says only, trust me, and then walk in the way that I direct you. God gets glory, and God shows his grace in another way, verses 23 through 28, and that is by destroying the enemies of his people. As soon as the sea is open and dry, the Egyptians are permitted to resume their pursuit and to pursue Israel right down into the seabed. And somewhere between the hours of 2 a.m. and 6 a.m., that's the morning watch that is mentioned there in verse 24, the Lord God, we are told, looks down from that pillar of fire and pillar of cloud, and he says, now I'm going to deal with the Egyptians. And he confuses them. He brought the army of the Egyptians into confusion. Now, we're not told exactly what that means. But whatever he did, they were not able to drive their chariots. He caused their chariot wheels to swerve, and he made them drive with difficulty. So the chariots of the Egyptians were like the grocery cart at Stop and Shop. And they couldn't get control of them. They're trying, and whether the wheels were getting stuck or what the problem was, we don't know. But they had great difficulty. And they knew, as a result of this, that it was the God of Israel causing it. The God of Israel was fighting against them. And so they say, essentially, let's get out of here. Let us flee from Israel, for the Lord is fighting for them against us. And then he speaks to Moses. And he says, Moses, let's bring the water back. Stretch out your hand over the sea so the waters may come back over the Egyptians, over their chariots and their horsemen. Do you not hear an echo of the Noahic flood? The children of Israel spared like Noah and his family, and suddenly the judgment of God upon the wicked comes as the water swallows them up and consumes them. God has brought his judgment upon the Egyptians. Finally, in verses 30 and 31, he manifests his glory and he shows his grace. By this great power, the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the shore. And when Israel saw the great power of God, they have two responses. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. When Israel saw the great power which the Lord had used against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. They feared him, and they believed. When you have seen the salvation of the Lord, it always produces holy awe and faith. And so in manifesting his glory and showing his grace, God produced a holy fear, a holy awe in his people, and a faith that his word could be trusted. Have you seen the power of God in your life? And has it resulted in fear and faith? Have you experienced your own exodus? And has anything changed as a result of it? There are many who would answer, you know, I've seen God's redemption. I've believed in Jesus. And they may actually think that they have, but there is no evidence of it. When you look at their lives, there is no holy awe. There is no fear. There is no reverence for God. Why not? Well, it may very well be that such a person has not actually believed according to the biblical definition of belief. You see, most people don't understand what it means to believe. Most people hear the word believe and they think it means to agree, to give intellectual assent to a proposition, to say that something is true. But that's not what biblical belief is. That's not biblical faith. Biblical faith, we've seen it in the crossing of the Red Sea, means to trust. The people of Israel could have stayed over on that other side of the sea and said, yeah, I believe God could get us across. But they wouldn't be trusting. They believed with trust when they took that step out between those walls of water and then kept going. Biblical faith is to give oneself over, heart and soul, to another. The Israelites exercised that kind of faith when they crossed the sea. They had no power to fight and destroy Egypt. They had no way of getting over or around the sea. They had nothing to do with holding the waters back They gave themselves over in complete and utter trust to the only one who was able to save them. Their faith made a difference. Their faith caused them to behave in ways that perhaps normally they wouldn't. They went down into the sea, not knowing that they'd reached the other side, not knowing what awaited them on the other side, but trusting that God knew and that He would bring them through. That's biblical faith. Likewise, the gospel demands your trust, not just an intellectual assent to some propositions. If you have heard the gospel presented in terms of a transaction, you do this and God will do that, then I would plead with you this morning to examine yourself, as Paul exhorts us in 2 Corinthians. Examine yourself to see whether you are in the faith. If your understanding of the gospel is that one must pray a prayer, that one must respond to an altar call, or walk an aisle, or that you must join a church, or that you must go to confession, or participate in the Mass, or partake in the Lord's Supper, or that you must be baptized, then you have been given a wrong understanding of the gospel. Because the gospel of Scripture is a gospel of justification by faith alone. If you have no holy awe for God, that may be the reason. There is only one saving response to the gospel, and that is trust. It is the recognition that you stand with your back to the sea, with the enemy pressing in upon you and nowhere to go. But this enemy is not Egypt. This enemy is your own sin. And unless you find some way of escape, then that enemy will destroy you. Because the wages of sin is death. But if you turn around, you will see that there has been a way open for you. But that way is not through the waters of the Red Sea. It is rather through the red blood of Jesus Christ, shed upon the cross for sinners. And in response to this offer of rescue and redemption, God requires not a sinner's prayer, not a walking of the aisle, not any religious ritual. He simply requires that which He also provides, that you turn away from dependence upon yourself and anything you can do, and you trust solely in what He has done. Trust Him. Trust the redemption which He has accomplished through His Son, Jesus Christ, and His death and resurrection. Trust Him for that which you were and are powerless to accomplish. And when you come to grips with your own helplessness and entrust yourself to Him, body and soul, then you will do as the Israelites did. And you will come out on the other side of that great work of redemption which God has accomplished, and you will stand in awe of the God who has accomplished it. And you will worship, and you will believe that He is the Lord. And your life will change. And He will cause you to walk in the way that He has prepared for you. Father, thank you for the gospel. Thank you for the picture of the gospel we have seen in Exodus. That we thank you, Father, for our Redeemer, for His shed blood. And we thank you that though there is nothing we can do to save ourselves, you have done all that is necessary. Oh, Father, for any who are here this morning who have never heard this before, convict them, Father, of their sin and of the truth of the gospel, and draw them to your Son. And we will give you thanks. And we will give you glory, and we will thank you for your grace. In His name.
all. Amen.
Amen.